Using a 10mm wrench, remove the two upper holding bolts located on the back plate from the burner chassis. Remove the drawer assembly by removing the locking screw from the combustion head air tube. Ensuring that the seam on the air tube is at the bottom, position the combustion head air tube on the chassis and reattach the air tube to the chassis using the same two bolts. Finger tighten the bolts at this stage until the drawer assembly is inserted and proper alignment is achieved. Loosen off the self-aligning retaining screw and remove the nozzle line and holder from the cross casting. Unscrew the plastic plug from the nozzle holder and discard. Select the correct nozzle according to the firing rate desired. After removing the plastic cap, insert the nozzle by holding it in its protective case and gently sliding it into the nozzle holder. Screw the nozzle into the nozzle holder hand tight, turning it by the housing only. Be careful not to touch the filter or the orifice. Once the nozzle is installed in the holder, use the appropriate nozzle tightening tool to finish tightening the nozzle. Reinsert the nozzle holder into the cross casting and tighten the self-aligning retaining screw until it aligns properly. At this time, you should verify the electrode settings according to the manual. Back off the three burner cover holding screws and remove the cover. Prior to mounting the burner, measure the insertion depth of the appliance to determine the position of the burner mounting flange on the combustion head. Next, to ensure the mounting gasket will fit over the appliance bolts as required, first reverse the flange and mount it over the bolts as a guide for preparing the gasket. Then, aligning the gasket with the edges of the flange, place it evenly over the bolts and lightly tap the bolt ends through the gasket with a hammer until the bolt ends punch through the gasket. The mounted gasket should look like this. Preassemble the two-piece semi-flanges by inserting the two long side bolts and securing them loosely with the nut supplied. Slide the semi-flange subassembly into position over the end of the air tube so that the machined face of the semi-flanges will meet the flange. Next, prepare the flange by inserting the two bolts through the recessed holes in the flange so that the hexagonal heads are flush with the flange surface. Secure the bolts in the flange with the two chrome nuts supplied. Mount the flange onto the semi-flange by sliding it over the air tube and inserting the flange bolt ends into the upper two holes in the semi-flange. Secure the flange to the semi-flange using the two remaining nuts. You are now ready to set the insertion depth. Using an adjustable square, measure and adjust the flange position for the proper insertion depth. Check that the flange is level. Secure the flange on the air tube by evenly tightening the semi-flange side bolts with a 10mm wrench and shut off the oil supply. Two oil lines are supplied with the burner pump set. The straighter line is for the supply, and the slightly more bent one is for the return. In a single line system, only the supply line is used. First, using a 13mm wrench, remove, then discard the supply port plug, identified by the leftmost arrow on the pump cover nearest the back plate. Install the oil line. Tighten the connection hand tight. Then rotate the oil line in its fitting, pushing the line into the slot in the back plate. Once the oil line is in place, use a 15mm wrench to tighten the connection. Install the metric to NPT adapter supplied with the burner to connect the pump to the fuel delivery system. Tighten both halves of the coupling using both 17 and 19mm wrenches. Shut off the oil supply. Install the supply line metric to NPT adapter supplied with the burner using pipe dope on the threads to ensure a proper seal. Secure in place. Using a 13mm wrench, remove the plugs from the supply and return ports and discard. Now convert the pump to a two-line system by installing the bypass screw on the end of the 2.5mm Allen key supplied with the pump. Insert the bypass screw into the return port and turn the Allen key until the screw is fully seated. Two oil lines are supplied with the burner pump set. The supply line is the straighter one, and the return line is slightly more bent to accommodate the burner cover. In a two-line system, both the supply and return lines are used. Install the supply line first into the supply port nearest the back plate. Tighten the line hand tight and position it in the lower slot in the back plate. Secure in place using a 15mm wrench. Attach the line to the metric to NPT adapter and tighten the coupling using both 17 and 19mm wrenches. Now, install the return line metric to NPT adapter and secure in place. Next, install the return line into the return port. Tighten hand tight and position in the back plate over top of the supply line. Use a 15mm wrench to tighten the connection. Connect the return line to the metric to NPT adapter and tighten the coupling. Turn on the oil supply. The application wiring runs from the safety limit to the operating control. Attach the cable harness to the burner backplate. Route the wires along the backplate underneath the motor and through the strain relief on the fan housing beneath the control box subbase. Tighten the strain relief, checking to ensure the wires are routed away from the burner cover. Now make the electrical connections. Attach the green earth ground wire directly to the chassis by inserting the uninsulated portion of the wire into the clip on the green painted Phillips screw, also identified by the ground symbol on the chassis. Tighten the screw. Connect the white neutral wire by backing off the N-terminal screw in the subbase and inserting the uninsulated portion of the wire into the terminal. Tighten the screw. Ensure a good connection by tugging slightly on the wire. Insert the black line wire into the L terminal, tighten the screw, and ensure a good connection. Remove the 24-volt relay kit from the package and prepare the bracket for mounting the printed circuit board. Insert the standoffs into the three large holes in the bracket, pushing them in until you hear an audible click. To install the 24-volt relay on the burner, first remove the strain relief from the burner chassis and discard. Place the prepared bracket over the locating pins on the chassis and secure with the retaining screw. Next, mount the 24-volt relay onto the bracket. Position the three holes in the printed circuit board over the standoffs on the bracket and push in slightly until you hear an audible click. Ensure that the relay is secure. Now make the electrical connections. Attach the ground wire to the chassis by inserting the uninsulated portion of the wire into the clip on the green painted Phillips screw, identified by the ground symbol on the chassis. Connect the white neutral power supply wire to the long white neutral wire from the 24-volt relay by joining the exposed wire ends together using a wire nut. Connect the black line wire from the 24-volt relay to the red line wire from the operating limit in a similar manner. Next, connect the short white neutral wire from the 24-volt relay to the N terminal on the subbase by backing off the terminal screw, inserting the uninsulated portion of the wire, and tightening the screw. Connect the red wire to the L terminal on the subbase in a similar manner. Check the connections by tugging slightly on the wires. Note that the electronic air shutter requires a constant 120-volt power supply source to the auxiliary terminal on the subbase. Route the wires from the cable harness along the backplate and underneath the burner motor. Loosen off the strain relief clamp, route the wires through the strain relief, and retighten the clamp. Now make the electrical connections. Connect the white neutral wire by backing off the N terminal screw in the subbase and inserting the uninsulated portion of the wire into the terminal. Tighten the screw. Insert the red line wire coming through the limit of the operating and limit safety control into the L terminal and tighten the screw. Insert the black constant power supply wire, which does not go through the operating limit control, into the auxiliary terminal and tighten the screw. Attach the green earth ground wire directly to the chassis by inserting the uninsulated portion of the wire into the clip on the green painted Phillips screw, also identified by the ground symbol on the chassis. Tighten the screw. Ensure all connections are sound by tugging slightly on each wire. Once all the application wiring is in place, we are ready to reinstall the integrated control. Refit the transformer by first tilting the control box up, inserting the ignition electrodes into the transformer, then pressing down slightly and resting the control box on the subbase. Now, firmly push the control box forward until the terminals connect with an audible click. Once the control is in place, ensure there is no gap between the bottom of the box and the subbase. Secure the control by tightening the side bolt. Using the AC scale on a multimeter, verify for 120 volts AC, plus or minus 10%, across the N and L terminals on the integrated control. Turn off the power supply to the burner. Remove the control box by loosening the side bolt, prying the box back with a screwdriver, and lifting the box off the subbase. Insert a jumper between terminals 5 and 6 on the subbase to allow the motor to run without firing the burner. Turn on the power supply. With the motor running, use the AC scale on a multimeter to verify for nominal 39 to 51 volts between terminals 3 and 7. Turn off the power supply to the burner. Remove the control box by loosening the side bolt, gently prying the box back with a screwdriver, and lifting the box off the subbase. Using the resistance scale on a multimeter, perform the following two checks. Check the starting circuit resistance across terminals 2 and 8. It should be 1.3 ohms, plus or minus 10%. Check the running circuit resistance across terminals 1 and 2. It should be 1,350 ohms, plus or minus 10%. Reinstall the control box. Turn off the power supply to the burner. Remove the control box by loosening the side bolt, gently prying the box back with a screwdriver, and lifting the box off the subbase. There are two methods of testing the capacitor. The first is by checking the actual capacitance using a multimeter. The second is a simple functionality check using a light bulb. Method 1, using a multimeter. Remove the capacitor wires from the terminals 3 and 9. Confirm that you have the correct leads. Using the capacitance scale on a multimeter on auto range, check the capacitance across the two leads of the capacitor. It should be 12.5 microfarads, plus or minus 5%. Method 2, using a light bulb. Remove the capacitor wires from terminals 3 and 9. Confirm that you have the correct leads. Install the white neutral wire of a pigtail socket containing a 100-watt light bulb to terminal 3. Install the black line wire to terminal 9. Connect a jumper across terminals 5 and 6. Restore the power. If the air shutter is activated, the light bulb comes on, and the motor starts, the capacitor is defective and should be replaced. There are two methods of checking the CAD cell. Method 1, removing the CAD cell and firing up the burner normally. Turn off the power supply to the burner. Remove the control box by loosening the side bolt, gently prying the box back with a screwdriver, and lifting the box off the subbase. Slide the CAD cell out of its slot in the bottom of the control box. Reinstall the control box. Power up the burner normally. Allow the burner to run through pre-purge and the trial for ignition period. If the control then goes out on lockout, the CAD cell is defective and should be replaced. Method 2, checking the CAD cell resistance using a multimeter. Remove the control box by loosening the side bolt, gently prying the box back with a screwdriver, and lifting the box off the subbase. Slide the CAD cell out of its slot in the bottom of the control box. The RIELLO control subbase comes factory pre-wired for all standard control functions. Here is the standard application wiring for burners equipped with the electronic air shutter. Here we see terminals 1 to 8, 9, and 11. Starting from the left, we have the neutral connection. The center terminal, used for lockout, is the remote sensing terminal. The live line connection on the right. And an additional auxiliary terminal, which provides constant power for the electronic air shutter. Turn off the power supply. Turn off the oil supply to the burner. Remove the bleeder plug from the pressure port. Install a pressure gauge in the port. If using a standard NPT gauge, a metric to NPT adapter is required. Open the oil supply. Turn on the power. Initially, the pressure gauge reading should be between 25 and 90 psi. Do not adjust the pressure until the burner fires and the pressure gauge needle moves to the set point. Now use a slot head screwdriver to turn the pressure. Shut off the power supply. Turn off the oil supply to the burner. To set the pump pressure on the F20, there are two adjustments required. First, the low fire pressure, adjusted by turning this screw on the high fire delay valve. Then, the high fire pressure, adjusted by turning this screw on the pump. This screw is used to open or close the high fire delay valve, forcing the burner into low fire or high fire operation. To make the pressure adjustments, begin by installing a pressure gauge in the pressure port of the pump. If using a standard NPT gauge, a metric to NPT adapter is required. Open the oil supply and turn on the power. During pre-purge, the pressure will read from 25 to 90 psi. As the burner goes into low fire operation, the pressure will rise to 105 psi. After a few seconds, the burner will go into high fire operation and the pressure will rise to 175 psi. To adjust the low fire pressure, bring the burner back into low fire operation by backing off the screw in the high fire delay valve until the pressure drops and the air shutter moves into its low fire position. Adjust the low fire pump pressure by turning the pump pressure adjustment screw on the high fire delay valve, clockwise for more pressure or counterclockwise for less pressure. To adjust the high fire pressure, close off the high fire delay valve by turning the delay screw until the burner goes into high fire operation and the air gate opens. Allow the pressure to rise. Adjust the high fire pump pressure by turning the pressure regulating screw located on the pump directly above the pressure port, clockwise for more pressure or counterclockwise for less pressure. When you move the turbulator forward, more air passes around the outside of the turbulator disc and less through the disc, reducing the turbulence of the flame pattern. Static pressure in the combustion head upstream of the turbulator disc is decreased. The pressure in the combustion zone is increased. The ability of the burner to supply larger volumes of air, accommodating higher firing rates, is increased. The flame pattern will be longer and softer in appearance. The flame temperature will be lower. The burner will be less sensitive to negative draft in the combustion zone. When you move the turbulator back, more air is forced through the turbulator disc and less around the outside of the disc, increasing the turbulence of the flame. Static pressure in the combustion head upstream of the turbulator disc is increased. The pressure in the combustion zone is decreased. The burner can supply only volumes of air which will accommodate lower firing rates. The flame pattern will be shorter and brighter in appearance. The flame temperature will be higher. The burner will be more sensitive to negative draft in the combustion zone.